Welcome to JCE Connect. In today's presentation, we'll be discussing on difference between flexible payment and rigid payment. In the earlier presentation, we had seen different types of payments and we had discussed in detail material and the different layers. So from that also we can see in our day-to-day life, as we are using flexible and rigid payments to move from one place to other, we have experienced also some of the things like comfort, noise level, and its durabilities, right? After construction, for how many years that was giving a good performance during its design life, right? So I'll go one by one. From technical point of view, if we see here, that is deformation in subgrade is transferred to the upper layer. So in case of flexible payment, the whatever stresses which are developed in the subgrade that are directly transferred to the upper layer, the deformation, cracks, or whatever may be the failures. So, whereas in case of rigid payment, the deformation in subgrade is not transferred to the subsequent layer. So, that is, as there is a slab action taking place in case of rigid payment, if any major failure or there is a disturbance, then only there is a that is transferred in the form of major failure of the payment. Rest, whatever small deformation, that will be taken care of by the slab action of the rigid payment. Whereas in case of flexible payment, if any small pocket gets weakened during the its settlement, or it may be because of water and other conditions in the subgrade, base, subbase, so that will be observed in the flexible payment. The automatically will observe there is a slight undulation, settlement of the wearing course also. Next, coming to the second point, that is design is based on load distribution characteristics, load distribution characteristics of the component layers. Yes, in case of flexible payment, we are will be using different materials and design. It is based on the load distribution, how that is at a 45 degree load distribution takes place. Whereas in case of rigid payment, design is based on the flexural strength of the slab action of the rigid payment. The concrete material, PQC, whatever, what is the flexural strength? So based on that will be its design is done. Whereas in case of a flexible payment, we'll be checking the CBR values, OMC densities, right? And here, yes, obviously the Marshall stability test will be conducting for the wearing course. But in case of rigid payment, mostly it is based on the flexural strength. And here in case of flexible payments, we see the lesser flexural strength. Whereas in case of rigid payment, it can accommodate higher flexural strength. It can serve higher flexural strength. Next is load distribution. Load is transferred by grain to grain action. Yes, in case of flexible payment, as in the first point we had mentioned, if there is any weak pocket in the subgrade, that is transferred, that we can see on the upper layer also. That is because there is a grain to grain action or grain to grain load distribution taking place. If any weaker pocket is there, then definitely that is observed in the upper layers. But in case of rigid payment, no such phenomena. Here it is a slab action will be taking place. And next, these flexible payments have low completion cost, but repair cost is very high. Yes, here as the cost of binding material, bitumen, is relatively lesser when it is compared to the cement in case of rigid payment. So overall construction cost, low cost of completion, initial cost is less in case of flexible payment, but its repair cost is very high, as it demands frequent maintenance. Whereas in case of rigid payments, it has low repair cost, but completion cost is very high. That is nothing but initial cost is high in case of rigid payment. Next is flexible payments have low lifespan. That is, its design life is 8 to 10 years or maximum 10 to 15 years. Whereas in case of rigid payments, as they demand less maintenance, their lifespan is more when it is compared to the flexible payment. That is, earlier 20 to 30, now it is designed up to of 30 to 50 years use of advanced materials. Next is surfacing cannot be laid directly on subgrade, but a subbase or a base is needed. So whatever wearing course, what we say, so that is not directly laid on subgrade or subbase or base subbase. So here we need some members like a base layer, but in case of rigid payment, directly you can lay it on the either base or subbase, any one of the layers directly laid, as there is a slab action will be taking place. Next is, in case of flexible payment, no thermal stresses are induced. 8 point, you can see no thermal stresses are induced, as a payment have the ability to contract and expand freely, as we are using bitumen as a binding material. In the presence of heat, it melts. It fluidity or working can be, it can be worked very easily. In case of very cold or lesser temperature, it is acts slightly rigid. But in case of rigid payment, the thermal stresses are more vulnerable to be induced, as the ability to contract and expand is very less in case of concrete. So it's thermal stresses for that we need to consider in the during the design, right? And here the flexible payment, 9 point, that is expand. Here we are not providing any expansion joints, as the thermal stresses are like it has the ability to contract and expand. But in case of rigid payment, there is a need to provide an expansion joint because of it's more vulnerable, this ability to contract and expand. And here in case of flexible payment, strength of road is highly dependent on the strength of subgrade. Yes, here as the load is transferred to the lower layers and it has a low flexural strength, in case of flexible payment, that is strength of subgrade is very important. In case of rigid payment, strength of the road is less dependent on the strength of the subgrade soil, right? So it is, and because of the slab action and a major load is transferred to the that is wearing course, and because of its good flexural strength, it's minimized and lesser load is transferred to the subgrade. Next comparison, that is rolling of surfacing is needed in case of flexible payment, 11th point. You might have observed during construction of wearing course of flexible payment, bituminous payment, that is you are using pneumatic tire rollers, steel drum rollers, right, for compaction. But in case of rigid payment, there is no rollers. It is the use of huge pavers, that is its thickness is predecided with respect to that. That is internally compacted, vibrated, and air voids are removed, and we are not using any rollers to compact in case of rigid payments. 12th point, road can be used for traffic within 24 hours. Immediately after construction of flexible payment, within 24 hours, We can open it for traffic. Commuters can use the road. But whereas in case of rigid pavements that need to be cured for minimum of 28 days, or if you are using any plastic, any agents which can cure your pavement early, so minimum of 14 days of curing is required. If you are using any admixtures, definitely the cost will increase for that such a large quantity of concrete. So definitely it requires or demands for more curing period. Next is force of friction is less, deformation in the subgrade is not transferred to the upper layers. Yes, the same, that is, force of friction is less, deformation. Deformation is not transferred to the upper layers. Here in case of rigid pavement, here that is force of friction is high. And next is damaged by oil and certain chemicals, as this bituminous binding material is obtained from petroleum product. So in case of heat, or if you are any during the transportation, during the usage of flexible pavement, if any the chemical, because of accidents or other conditions, if it comes in contact with the bitumen, then there may be chances of bitumen may lose the binding property, or it may melt, or it may lose the strength, right? So, or there may be more slippery in case of flexible pavement, but in case of rigid pavement that is not damaged by the oil or grease or other chemical material chemicals. So that it's here you can see that is rigid pavement life is high, that is 20 to 30 or 30 to 50 also you can say, minimum of say 30 years you can mention in case of rigid pavement. Flexible payments design life is less, initial cost is less in case of flexible payment, initial cost is more in case of rigid payment. You can remember with respect to cost of cement bags, so many number of cement bags are required. Next is its maintenance cost is high in case of flexible payments, maintenance cost is less in case of rigid pavement. Most important differentiating point is flexural strength. Very low flexural strength in case of flexible pavement, very high flexural strength in case of rigid pavement. Apart from that, you can mention that is with respect to night visibility is good in case of rigid pavement, whereas it is must in that is road marking is must in case of flexible pavement. Otherwise it is difficult to judge the edges of the pavement because of its black or dark in color, right? And riding quality is very good in case of flexible pavement. Riding quality is not much good in case of rigid pavement because of that is noise created by the friction between tires and the rigid pavement surface. That is, noise is more in case of rigid pavement, noise is less in case of flexible pavement. That's why you might have observed in case of in the earlier days the national golden quadrilateral project, 50% of flexible, 50% of rigid pavement they had mentioned, and now in the almost 15 years it's over. The golden quadrilateral project we see in from Belgaum to Kolhapur or Pune, Bangalore stretch. So in wherever the rigid pavement is there also they have laid upper layers with the flexible pavement, so that it is making less noise. If you are running your vehicles at higher speed on flexible pavement, yes, definitely that creates a noise, and it affects the comfort of the rider. That is because of noise, comfort level is reduced, and there is a vibration also. Even slight mm of compaction or because of vehicular movement, that is not it's very rigid. So even slight 1 or 2 mm or 10 to 15 mm of settlement that can be experienced in your comfortable car if you are moving on a rigid pavement, but that is not directly experienced if you are moving on a flexible pavement, right? And tire consumption is more in case of rigid pavement, whereas flexible pavement that is not affected because of smooth riding quality is observed in case of flexible pavement. So these are the few differentiating points. If you want, you can make a number of differentiating points between flexible pavement and rigid pavement, but most important is with respect to its initial and maintenance cost, with respect to strength, load distribution, grain to grain load distribution in case of flexible pavement, here it is slab action in case of rigid pavement. So such kind of curing period and it's number of joints which we provide in case of rigid pavements. Here we are not providing any joints in case of flexible pavement. Some of the technical points you can include in the initial differentiating points, and later you can compare with respect to its comfort, then its respect to visibility and other parameters. But in the initial points, you compare with respect to the structural differentiating points rather than the functional differentiating points. Thank you very much. Please do like and subscribe.